Together this picture and putting together Thank you. You learn on your job. And so that's where people are learning these skills. Do this says, how can these corporations justify the fact that these dwarves, people live in shanties? Now, these are the kind of questions that I cannot answer. And I have looked to see. I know it says the justification given for the translocation of jobs was that it would result in a reciprocal market expansion. And this is it. We would help them become much more self-sufficient over there. And then this would ultimately trickle up and trickle down and help our economy. John says the paradox is that unemployed workers here cannot buy foreign-made goods, and foreign workers cannot afford American goods. Was the justification false? And I would say very much so, because when we think about it, is the money actually trickling down? There are some parts of Juarez that are growing and expanding. However, the vast majority of people are still experiencing extreme poverty. I want to take a look really quick at the next clip. And it's about a young lady who's following this case. And I asked this question, if this was American young teenage girls going out into the workforce for the first time, would we see this as something that we can just kind of ignore? Why isn't this on the news every day? So let's take a look at the next clip. Interesting, because she said, you know, she fit the profile of that income. heaven, is it possible that we're not thinking about this? And it does relate to work. Richard says, how can U.S. companies, how are they supposed to get involved in Mexico's internal politics and cultural issues without being seen as overbearing North Americans? And what is very interesting here is that this is where I think we overthink the issue sometimes and we overthink the problem. One of the issues for these young women is that there are 4 or 5 shifts at these factories, and these women are being killed on their way back and forth to Juarez public transportation. We don't have to set up a lot of policies in order to simply provide a work bus. If these corporations are making such good money, the corporations have a lot of resources, why can't they provide a work bus that drops these young women off at the major locations so they don't have to walk through the deserted streets, they don't have to walk through the men that are jobless because of how these factories are being set up. So we don't have to get into policy, we don't have to have a big dog and pony show, but there are little things that those companies can do. Mary says, I think the corporation should at least send a bus or something for the workers. This could benefit, be a benefit for the worker and the company. Of course it could. However, for that company, these young women are expendable. And that's the whole point of the discussion. These young women, there's one more to come in and replace them every single time. And so the corporations, and remember, we're talking about the movement of people. Now we're talking about this movement of businesses globally. While the corporations are not necessarily concerned with the people. Cheryl says, how can there be reciprocal economic gains when women are being murdered? This is a real serious issue. I mean, every time I check it out and investigate it, I am amazed. I started studying this when it was 200 women. And I thought, well, surely it's not going to get any more than that. These companies are going to step in and add lighting and a road and a patrol, something to secure their workforce. However, they don't have those requirements. Lauren says, I wonder if these girls are getting their paychecks stolen as they're leaving work. That's a variable, and it's quite possibly the case. Do they know if these girls are being killed on paydays? This is a study dying to happen because they don't really know. And what I find interesting is in how this is all related to our global environment. We talk about the people that are being elevated, but on one level, these young women are being elevated economically. On another level, they're being ostracized socially. And one of the other variables here is that the men, I'm not saying that all the men are killing them or anything like that, but many of the men are actually resentful that these young women are no longer in the homes, and these young women are now the breadwinners and having these factory jobs. And so this globalization, it messes with the gender relations as well as the economic relations. All right, let's get to immigration because I want to set up some stuff before we meet with our guest speaker. In your book, America, What Went Wrong, he talks about Maytag or losing out to Mexico. And what he says is that, you know, you can look at this from both sides here. You can look at this from on many sides, the corporation side, and then you can look at it from the side of that person in the Midwest who's losing their job. And then you can look at it from the side of the people in the country that are gaining that employment. What else are they gaining along with these jobs? And in Juarez, what it is they're getting some very strange gender relations. And it's even playing out more how powerless women are when it comes to labor. These women can't even argue for a bus because if we don't meet him, there's going to be another group of women to come in and replace him. You know, Gary says, I feel your solution helps, but it doesn't solve the problems of kidnapping in daylight hours. It's true. The situation that occurs very often there is more of a criminal issue than a worker issue. I kind of think it's completely related. Yes, the work is enticing, and it makes them become victims. The work is not enticing. This work is necessary to eat. And so the women are not going because it's going to be a little bit better job and they can afford the boutique. This is the foundation of their income for their home. So these jobs are the same as American jobs are here. They're required for us to live. And so for these workers, these jobs are required as well. Tara says the same thing happens when the U.S. Golden and ghetto countries. And so there are many, so many ghetto murders get unsolved even when it happens in broad daylight. And this is very, very true. And it is because these are expendable. I am loving the conversations. Nina says every corporation should have some accountability to the community they're doing business in. Corporations try to make money, and even at the expense of seeing murders happen around them. This is what I think when I think about the shareholders who are reaping the huge profits and not doing anything to try to help this problem. The companies have a sweatshop mentality. The bottom line is money. And this is from Rhonda. The money is the reason for their being there. And the lack of rules and regulations and regard for the public is just a plus. And this is very, very true. And so this is one aspect of globalization, the social impact of it as it relates to work and how work changes the lives of many, many people. Let's move to talk specifically now about immigration. And immigration, and what I felt, I wanted to come here and I wanted to give you hard and fast and true immigration statistics. And after a summer of searching, what I found is that they don't really exist that way. Depending on what you're looking for, the statistics are going to be out there to support what you want to see. Immigration is this movement of people over national borders. We talked about moving corporations, now we're going to move the people. And what is interesting is that just like the globalization issue, immigration is just as contentious. And I want us to take a look at one perspective. So let's take a look at, we're going to actually skip the Solis clip, but I want to go to clip number 6. And this is immigration gun balls, because I want to give us a base of something to discuss.
No congressional action should occur without consulting these charts. In 1970, 203 million people were scattered. Which people will be represented below this chart. What this chart shows you, what this screen shows you, is the growth of the U.S. population since 1970. In 1973, the American people moved to a below replacement level for 2 million Indians that we have on average. Fewer than 2.1 children per woman. And below replacement fertility, we will eventually stabilize our population among both the rest of the advanced nations of the world. But we still have growth. This is the growth of births that are dense in the recent years is that the baby boomers are the first of that little bulge. We had to move through our childbearing years. So even though we had small families, there were so many of us, we kept growing. Doctors and soldiers want what happened to the 1970 stock population. Throughout the next 50 years. That is, they took the people who were here in 1970, subtracted the deaths of those people, added their descendants, and subtracted the deaths of their descendants. They found that this is what would happen. But as you can see, the population right now is very slowly growing in the next 5 years, you'll stop growing and grow a little bit more with baby boom, then it'll take off. And then it reaches a peak. That's 3.7 million in 2 years, 2030. This is not a zero immigration level, however, it's a replacement level immigration. That is, replacement level opportunity is when you have the same number of people being born, these are 9 each year. Replacement level immigration is when you have the same number of people being needed, it's a B each year. Right now, about 200,000 Americans need the country permanently each year. This is what the Census Bureau tells us actually happened in the last 20, 25 years. As you can see, our population growth has doubled over what it otherwise would have. This graph represents every immigrant who came since 1970 in the same attendance, minus the deaths of those groups. There's been as much population growth of immigration and some international growth, but not as a stock population. And it has meant that we had to double all the additional infrastructure expenditures we had in this country. We had to build twice as many schools, twice as many streets to be replaced. We had to build twice as many roads and streets. All of the needs of this country, the additional needs of this country, have doubled because of this radical new immigration policy of the United States government. In California, the State Department of Education has found that they have to build an entire elementary school every single day of the year. School every single day of the year in perpetuity, and that's all as the current immigration continues to become just a conservative and of immigration. So what does Congress have in store for us right now? The Census Bureau tells us that if Congress does not lower the flow of immigration here right now, looking at a future that looks like this. As you can see, the numbers go completely off the charts. The Census Bureau tells us that this will be our future if immigration continues at today's rates. This is what we're going to be leaving for our children and our grandchildren by the end of this century. This is not your gesture, this is not subjective, this is not what might be, this is what will be. If Congress refuses to lower immigration to something like a traditional level, there are some Americans who have very sincere feelings and have played in efforts in order to show our concern for the third world. Is immigration an effective tool? This illustration I use is gumball, because I'm seeing about one. Now, what if you about what we take in a year in immigrants? This is not a small number because remember, this one gumball worth of immigration is driving every bit of this red. Each year in our bank of Italy, we try to rescue about this number from third world poverty. Not many people in the world are equally deserving, but it's kind of a humanitarian concern on our part. We have to have some kind of benchmark, and I use Mexico. 25% of the immigrants in the 1980s came from Mexico. Depending on the value of Mexico at the time, the average Mexican makes about 1/10 the amount of money that the average American makes. That's poor. I'd say it's deserving of our compassion. But how long are more impoverished than the average Mexican? And the answer is 4,600. Million people. 4.6 million people in the world are more impoverished than average this year. If immigration is policy to help the people of the third world, we should watch it very closely. Don't miss this. Some of you watch us, you watch the third world changes each year when we take many people. See, there can never be any hope that the people of the third world is here when they live. Most of those people, 99.1% of those people who never leave, they're stuck where they are. They have to be where they're going. If you care about these people, you have to figure out ways to help them here. Because they lose everything for different reasons. It won't make any difference in the world. Now, in many ways, the Americans can help third world nations.
that the immigration is not for another. Is that another issue here? Is that that's the issue of safety valve? Since the 1950s, people have been talking about how the United States has to take more population of Latin American countries. That's those countries pop up. Can that work? Well, no, it can't. I'll show you why. The fact is that last year, we took about 1 million people. But last year, the third world added births over deaths. 180 million people entered the world. And this year, we'll take 1 million people. And this year, we're going to add more people. And next year, the U.S. government insists on bringing this exorbitant, non-traditional level of immigration, ranking another 1 million people. These people will spread another more than 1 million people. There's no way that we can ever get ahead of this. There cannot be a safety valve. We can take thousands a year. Someone will destroy social fabric in this country. Someone will destroy environmental resources. There will be any possibility of most of the people who are having any kind of a decent standard of living but still not get ahead of this.
All right, let's think about what he said. The rate that poverty grows worldwide, our U.S. immigration is not going to actually solve any of those problems. So let me outline that argument because I'm going to give you both sides and then let you guys kind of duke it out. What he's saying is that, look, yes, we can have some immigration policy. However, our immigration policy is never going to solve the ills of the world. And so, therefore, rather than focusing on that, we need to focus on working on protecting and securing the American economy. That was Roy Beck, and he is an, I would say, an immigration reform, anti-liberal, open immigration kind of advocate. And what he's saying is that, listen, if you add it up and if you do the math, immigration policies are actually not going to help anybody, but what they are going to do is hurt the American worker. And he pointed out a couple of numbers, and I just wanted to mention the average Mexican makes 1/10 of what the average American makes. But then he said there were about 4 billion people in the world that actually make less than what the average Mexican makes. So when you think about the oath of office and when people are coming, and why are people coming here, we have to then begin to think about the social conditions that they're leaving as it relates to employment and just general living conditions. I want to, before we go to the break and before we have our speaker come on, I want to go to clip 7 because this provides another perspective. That was one perspective on the immigration issue. Clip 7 talks about if we don't have immigration, we will not have enough workers to do those basic jobs that Americans are not choosing to do. So let's go to clip 7, immigration, the cost of not having enough workers.
A couple of years ago, when the Colorado legislature cracked down on illegal immigration, Colorado farmers complained that new laws would make it hard for them to find workers to harvest their crops. Now the farmers' fears appear to have come true, and the legislature is looking for ways to help them with the guest worker program. First on this year, the Gallup reports.
Sakata Farms near Denver is cultivating mesquite for broccoli, a bitter gamble for the owner who says there may not be anyone here in June to help harvest it. Bob Sakata and many Colorado's farmers are in desperate need of field hands. Sakata supports a bipartisan bill currently making its way through Colorado's legislature that would allow the state to help the agriculture industry hire more workers.
The federal government is broken.
Representative Marshall Huber, who introduced the bill, says without this kind of assistance, everyone will suffer.
Because it is our economy, it is our farmers, it is our consumers who are going to be negatively affected in the end.
The proposal allows state agencies to work with hiring agents in Mexico, among other countries, to recruit and vet labor prospects to come to Colorado on federal visas. Those visas are fast-tracked by the state.
So if you get a whole population that used to be in the state to service the farm workers, and they're just not coming anymore.
In 2006, Colorado voters clamped down on illegal immigration at the time, earning a reputation as the toughest state in the nation on this issue. Back then, critics and business owners predicted the worker supply would dry out.
The farmers who attempted to get more money, they attempted to go out and look for employers, employees, and they just haven't been able to.
The bill would also force employers to provide transportation to and from the workers' home countries, as well as housing while in Colorado.
What else is a nice solution at this time?
Fighting Passage is the Colorado Immigrant Rights Coalition, saying any guest worker program should stay in the hands of the federal government, which relies on our workers and industries beyond the farm.
High-tech occupationals, engineering, professionals, every sector of the economy, I think, is affected by the local immigration system.
Farmers like Bob Sakata say their industry needs action now, because this year, if there's crop failure, it might not be a result of the weather. In Denver, Alicia Acuna, Fox News.
So, look at what's going on in Colorado, and I've actually seen some of this firsthand. They can't find workers. I don't know if I mentioned that I'm actually a rural sociologist, and my area is looking at how human beings interact not only in the urban environment, but also with the natural environment. And one of the issues that is going on in America and actually worldwide is that young people do not go into agriculture. And so one of the problems we have here is that we can't find workers to harvest these crops. Mary says it seems that when someone can simply simplify such a monumental problem as immigration into gumballs in a jar, then they are sculpting a demonstration fit for their views rather than presenting the many aspects of the problem. To me, this is a real disservice. She didn't like the gumballs. It didn't make a good visual for Mary. And I'm not arguing for this person or against this person, but I think what they were trying to show was the actual scope of the problem or the scope of the issue. And we're talking about immigration and we're talking about the new coming labor force. Once all of those gumballs are also people who need jobs. And so when you think about it and you begin to focus on what billions of people actually look like, I think that's why the gumballs were kind of, an interesting visual. But let's think about this clip that we just saw, because here we have now a real problem. How do you anti-immigration advocates out there argue for this? Because we have a situation where the people coming in from other countries are actually providing a real service that benefits the rest of the American population. And so now we've seen two sides, one side arguing that it's too much, and then one side arguing that, however, we need these populations. Richard said, if the labor cost gets high enough, then it will be profitable to invent and sell a machine to do the labor, and somebody will. The technology comes, but farming, it's always a little slow because the crops are so delicate. And so until someone invents the cotton gin for picking lettuce and onions and all of that, it's still going to have to be done by hand. And it's done by hand all over the world. And what is interesting about agriculture in terms of its labor value, it's not seen as valued as, for example, Tom Hanks being a movie actor and working on stage and making $1 million. The farmers don't clear that kind of money, even though what they do is necessary for all of us. So morning coming, and I have some other clips. And what I think I'm going to do with the class is I may spread the schedule out a little bit because we're trying to cover really big topics, and I thought that I could cover them once a week. And then I hit it, but you really can't because you have a lot of issues to talk about. The one issue, before we go to the break and get ready for our speaker, is think about what they're saying in Colorado. And a couple of weeks ago, I talked about not being able to find jobs for Americans. But how many of you that are unemployed out there would actually go pick apples or harvest onions or lettuce or any of those things or even pick cotton? How many of you would actually choose that as a profession? When I lived in Missouri, I lived close to the Tyson Chicken Plant. And what was very interesting is I lived in a very small town. Once the kids went into high school, they did not want to stay in the small town. They did not want to work on the farms, and they absolutely did not want to work at the Tyson Chicken Processing Plant. And so what the plant did, and this was really incredible, they actually went overseas. And I don't think the population they brought in were Mexicans. I believe these people were from Guatemala. They brought busloads of people to northern Missouri to work in this chicken factory. Alina says, why can't Colorado find people within the city to work in these fields? I'm sure they pay minimum wages. There's so many homeless people that end up in the streets, and this is because they lost their job. And I'm asking you to think critically and honestly, how many of those homeless are going out to the farms to pick the labor? In a society, particularly in an industrial society, we have divided work into prestigious and non-prestigious. So when we think about agriculture, picking cotton, planting food, we actually see that as a very non-prestigious form of earning a living. You make your money with your hands. And I would venture to say that there are not a lot of Americans that are volunteering for those types of jobs. In Arkandale, Arkansas, in Arkandale, Arkansas, a raid came in and armed immigration agents found half of the workers, 119 of the workers in this poultry plant. If you've ever been to a chicken processing plant, it's a hard job and it's not a fun place to work. But they found that 119 of these workers were actually detained and sent back to Mexico and Arkansas. Well, the community rallied because they needed those workers back. There were not enough people within the community who wanted to do that work. And so here now we have the line in the sand when it comes to immigration and labor. So let's get ready to meet our guest speaker. And I want you guys to think of your questions. Remember, you can also call in. So let's take a short break. And when we come back, we'll open up our discussion about immigrant rights and what's been going on in Los Angeles. So see you in a minute.
For watching PhD television program series from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
I'm Bill Duncan, Professor of Theater Arts at Cal State Dominguez. I'd like to invite you to come and see our next production, Electricida, so far. This production is based on the Greek production of Electricida, so far. It's not an unusual tale. The loser play about the village against their mother, killing their father, and a farm. Sets it in East LA, so it becomes something of a biopic tragedy. And in Lucida, she sees that maybe she's a very passionate person and is out to revenge. For those who love you, this film is a target of many plays, although this is in November for the opening of the event.
I'm going to whatever that might be for you to do. It's very often seen that you can tell that that doesn't change. But the same thing is always trying to do to the other stuff.
On this job, safety is our first concern. There's a lot that could go wrong. Unfortunately, we have Kent State Data Service, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first.
Stock representative in my store, representative
cases, we've opened over 4,000 applicants. We have had 25 jobs, and you know, some really helped us find the changes and out of all these people.
Our business side, of course, occupies our training that provides resources, contacts, also provides a resource for training individuals. Take some of the agricultural training uses, classes, and areas that they do.
It was just a great experience. Members of the West Stop were always helpful in understanding
the services that the business is seeing. So, the resource group is here for you. 231-7799. What is our website? That's a big resource now.
East Stop is your resource for business in South Bay.
This is my heresy.
Sociology 315. My name is Dr. Squires. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable channel and webcast on the internet each week. This fall, we're broadcasting three channels: Communications 300, Organizational Communications, on Tuesdays from 7 to 9. Sociology of Work, Sociology 315, on Saturdays from noon to 2, and Labor Law, Labor 412, on Sundays from noon to 2. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you can earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in any of these classes. All of the courses you need to complete your degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years and then started over. If you would like any more information on the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv or give us a call at 1-866-278-6789. And welcome back to the class. when we left, I had kind of left you with two different perspectives on immigration, arguing that it's too much, and then one side arguing that however we need immigrants, the country is in dire need of people, and these people are providing services that we are not going to get otherwise. And we have our guest speaker here, Jorge Mario Cabrera. He is the Director of Community Education and Public Affairs for the Coalition for Humane Immigrant Rights in Los Angeles. And welcome to our program. And before we begin to really get into it, I want to make a point to remind the students about immigration in its historical context. Because when we're talking about immigration now, we're talking about a large degree Spanish immigration. However, the questions and issues have existed in this country for a long time. When we talk about the Irish immigration in the 1800s, the arguments were just as contentious on both sides. There were too many Irish coming into America. They were taking the jobs. These people were not as good as us, etc., etc. And so the Irish actually had to struggle in order to kind of claim their status as Americans, develop that status. And also, the Chinese experienced the same kind of immigration exclusion. There was even the Chinese Exclusion Act that said, well, your Chinese laborers can't come. We don't need any more people coming to compete, for example, for American jobs. And so I want to remind the students that what we see happening today is actually part of a larger issue as it relates to who is American, when do you become American, how can you come to America, and what are your rights once you get here. So, Ms. Cooper, can you tell me a little bit about yourself and a little bit about your organization? Thank you. are pulling people to the country and pushing them out of their country. And the idea is it's opportunity. You know, people are coming for the social opportunity because for many the situation is becoming so dire where they are. You know,
it's not all
you're seeing is that they're actually good attacks from all groups on all sides. case, this is not specific to Black populations, Jewish populations. It's kind of like, who is going to be the immigrant group that we're going to blame? Who can we target? Let me ask you to make a comment about David's point about not being documented, not having the correct license, and the appropriate insurance. Does your organization deal with that kind of issue?
That's true. In order to get a license on them, you do have to present a social security number, a social security number, or a California ID, which you cannot get unless you are documented as an Indian resident. So that's one of our problems, which is that those are the inconveniences. The information is not placed in those models.
Here, how do you feel about this policy where the undocumented workers here are able to get certain licenses in order to be able to do business and conduct the business here? Do you agree? I have a question here from Richard, and I may put this question towards the end, but I want to just read it. Could you please compare how Mexico deals with illegal immigration on our southern border with how they want us to deal with their hours? And I want to come back to Richard's question because I actually do have a clip from Rush Limbaugh that outlines his immigration policy that deals specifically with this point. So if we don't get to this point, Richard, and this class, we will start with your question at the beginning of the next class. And so let me go on and ask some specific questions. What kind of immigration reform would you like to see? What specific things do you want to see done in a society that you think would not only help the incoming immigrants, but also the rest of the U.S. population?
World, and in this world, is now on migration, as we also
one of the things that Tara, one of the students, says is a lot of middle-class families actually depend on undocumented immigrants for affordable child care. So there are a lot of levels here where this is a part of our society that we're not talking about.
Partly that immigrants are from both family members.
$7 million in funds that they couldn't properly credit, and it is coming from undocumented people being into this room. And one of the arguments people make is that these immigrants are not paying taxes. So how do you address that issue?
These are just first learning. I figure that I'm not just using the domain to be undocumented residents. As you know, Thank you.
experienced really forgive the 12 years you've been here? Is it appropriate to make these people pay back services or pay a large fee for being able to be given that privilege? How do you fall on that issue?
It's early that this will be paid much to charge so the penalty of having this offense is present for authorized. We argue that it has to be reasonable. It has to be also practical. Obviously, if you make it $5,000 a head, it's going to be very difficult for families to pay that amount of cash. But again, in the shadows, if you make it the deposit from the SU, then you have to go back to your country and then wait 6 months or something and then wait while you come in. That is unreasonable. You can have very many people in both of the countries that are just very unstable.
Right.
All die.
Yeah. They may not make it back. They may not make it back. We have a call from email from Lauren. I would condemn any illegal workers, at least in Orange County, have very good work ethics. They also spend a lot of their money here, too. Of course, some of it goes back to Mexico. And I was looking for the statistics. I think it's U.S. immigrants send about $40 billion back home every year. And this is actually not new. This has been occurring. It occurred with the Chinese, and this was the critique of the Chinese in the 1800s, was that they were sending all their money back outside of the United States. We have a caller. Let's see who we have.
Gary.
I'm Gary from Sacramento. Do you have a question or a comment?
Yes, I do. I do have a comment for the speaker, the guest speaker there. I work with a state. I worked on this project 20 years for the Department of the Vehicle, and I worked on every lighting bill and the vehicle bill. I do have problems with the bill because there's no security safeguard for the undocumented worker. You don't know who you're licensing. It's not the same like, you know, it's not the same that you have someone that's going to have an INS card and you're coming in or they're coming in with a birth certificate bill. But, and there also, there's no, like, you see my thing, it's unrealistic for someone to go back, but we're making it that they have no incentive to go back home also.
Okay.
And I have a concern there. My last concern would be is that there's criminals coming over here. They're undocumented, and we have problems already here in the country, and this is compounding the problem.
Okay, Gary, he brings up a couple of points. There's no safety involved in knowing who you're getting the license to. And one of the things I think is interesting, and people always do this, they bring up the element of criminality, and it almost gets generalized out to an entire population. And that's one of the issues when you start talking about that, because all of the data shows that the vast majority of immigrants are law-abiding citizens.
And also, he said the statistics are linked to the fact that recent immigrants commit far less serious crimes than first generation or second generation immigrants. And that we've been learning to learn from this society. Just like the immigrants, when they come to this society, let's remember that there's also no security checkup for a resident. United States,
saying you can't, if you're going to do the license, you can't label it because you're actually then setting up early targets. All right, our phone lines are blowing up. We have two calls. Let's take our first caller. And this is Linda from Sherman Oaks. Hi, Linda.
Hi.
What's your question?
Well, a question. I think it's a mistake. I just think that you always say that people are living in the shadows, undocumented people are living in the shadows. And I don't find that so at all. Half a million of them marched over a year ago, those marches for amnesty. And also, they're also trying to join labor unions for car washers and for housekeepers. I mean, these people are not living in the shadows. And when you say they pay taxes, they don't pay taxes on houses, because most of them don't own houses where they pay sales tax. That does not count for the amount of money they take out in benefits for using our health care system, our school system, and everything. What they're putting into the system doesn't amount to what they're taking out. Also, for everyone, child in a person has the Hispanic food that Hispanic society put out. That the Hispanics are having eight children. So you're bringing in a bunch of people who are having tons of children, and they can't even afford to take care of them. So who's taking care of them? We are. We cannot afford to take care of a whole other country.
Okay, Linda makes a point that a lot of people have been telling you how to do address your point. And let me make a note too. In her voice, you can also hear her fear in the way that what we're doing is kind of stacking the deck. How would you respond to
her? I appreciate the viewers' questions because it is this time of very direct, honest question and answer.
Situation
shelter. Those are the main things that we need in order to stop the crime rate. I mean,
Ellie,
are hungry and babies are crying.
I'm going to have to say thank you for your comment. We have one more minute left. And so he says, I think this is actually a good last place to leave it. It's when we think about this issue, we have to think about people as human beings. Is there one last comment that you would like to leave them with to give them something critical to think about? 30 seconds.
I think we have to look at our small surroundings and say,
think about everything that we've raised. Clearly, we couldn't get to a lot of things. I'd like to say thank you to Mr. Cabrera for coming in and talking to us. And we do need this dialogue, and we need it to be open, and we also need to put it in the appropriate context to realize there's a little bit of validity on everybody's side, so we have to understand the arguments, and we encourage your comments out there. To read more about it, I will put up information on their website on Blackboard so you can get a link and find out a little bit more about what they do. And when we come back, we'll continue this and then move on to talk about the rest of society at work. So thank you once again, and thank you to our guest speaker. See you next week. I'm going to go to the hospital.